Robert McDonnell, your research deals with youth and unemployment across Europe, but I know that you prefer to use the term underemployment rather than unemployment. Can you explain why?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's important to have a focus on youth unemployment and not forget that problem, of course. But I think the problem of underemployment is as significant, if not more significant. By underemployment, we can mean different things. We can mean people who are in part-time work but really would like a full-time job. They're underemployed. We can think of people who are, as in my research that I've been doing in Teesside in northeast England, about people who are forever churning between unemployment and jobs, and unemployment and jobs, who are so sporadically employed but would prefer more stable full-time employment. And finally, we can think of underemployment in terms of people who are overqualified for the jobs that they're doing. So, for instance, perhaps graduates or people with high skills who are working in low-skilled employment, they can be classed as underemployed as well. Now, this problem or the extent of underemployment is quite significant and certainly exceeds the problem of youth unemployment.
Now, the political answer to both unemployment and underemployment is often education. Across Europe, governments stress the need to educate the youth to transition to a skilled economy. And you see some problems with that. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Well, I think one of the, all the particular sorts of examples of underemployment that I've just given would problematize or throw that education as the answer solution into question. So, you know, in the UK, for instance, we have a high proportion of graduates now who are working in low-skilled jobs, you know, and that number is increasing. I can't remember the exact figure, but 35%, I think, of graduates who are well into the labour market now are still working in low-skilled jobs. And that in itself, I think, throws into doubt some of the orthodoxy that we have about the high skills economy and about how the economy is only going to be one of better skilled, higher skilled jobs. We have this term in the UK about the hourglass economy. That means that yes, there are jobs being created at the very top of the labour market, but also there are jobs being created at the bottom of the labour market, low skilled, low paid jobs, and we've had a hollowing out of the middle, you know, of middle-level jobs, the sorts of jobs that many graduates might have moved into. There is certainly a question about the demand then from employers for high-skilled graduate-level employment of the sort that might be gained by people who are going through extended education.
In your presentation here at the SFI conference, you mentioned the term precariat, which is not a very well-known term in Denmark. Could you just explain to us what that means?
Yeah, it's a relatively new term, a concept associated with Professor Guy Standing, but not just with Guy Standing. But his idea is that we have a new class emerged globally, particularly in the West, a class of people who are united by their insecure conditions of employment, their insecure conditions of life. So on the precariat idea would be one that would encompass more disadvantaged working class young people who are churning between unemployment and low paid jobs, but also would encompass perhaps more affluent graduates or middle class young people who've achieved an education but who are still finding it a struggle to get a secure way of life through employment. So it's the idea that precarity or precariousness, the precariat, encompasses the conditions of a wide range of young people now, is that idea, the idea of the precariat.
Thank you.